Prophecies are dangerous things. I believe you have a role to play. As does another. The king in the north, Jon Snow.
Jon Snow? Ned Stark's bastard.
You know him?
I traveled with him to the wall when he joined the Night's Watch.
And why do you think the Lord of Light singled out this Jon Snow, aside from the visions you've seen in the flames, that is?
Hey everyone, and welcome to another Game of Thrones video. Today, we are going to take a deeper look at Chapter 32 of Dance with Dragons that is deep with symbolism, foreshadowing, and a huge clue for the endgame of a Game of Thrones. This video is sponsored by Shire Post Mint, who make amazing licensed Game of Thrones coins. We are doing a giveaway for the Iron Coin of the Faceless Men for the month of March, and there are 10 different ways to enter this giveaway. So make sure you don't miss out on this awesome chance, and make sure you check out the link in the description of this video on how to enter. "Show me Stannis, Lord," she prayed. "Show me your king, your instrument." This is Melisandre's prayer in Chapter 32 of A Dance with Dragons. She sees many things in the vision that follow, but Stannis is not one of them. We know that the show doesn't follow the books word for word and step by step, but the show does honor the books. While in this vision, Melisandre is also looking for a Grey Girl on a dying horse who she believes to be Arya fleeing from Ramsay. But we know that Dark Destiny belonged to Jane Poole, Sansa's friend, and the daughter of Ned Stewart in the books, but this was given to Sansa in the show. We also see visions of towers by the crumbling sea under a dark wave, and the others coming to a settlement under a gray cliff and extinguishing the many lights in the caves beneath. Some of these visions bear resemblance to the visions given to Sandor Clegane in the show, so even though there are changes from one storytelling medium to another, the core of what happens in the show can still be predicted by what has occurred in the books. The imagery is very strong in these visions, and while Melisandre has prayed to see R'hllor's king, his instrument, the people she sees are Bran, Bloodraven, and Jon Snow. The very first clear image mentioned is the eyeless faces staring again from sockets weeping blood. This is of course the weirwood trees and their carved faces, and it appears as though she has seen these before, as it is specified that she is seeing them again. She does not refer to them as weirwood trees though, or heart trees, or the weirwood faces. She sees them as eyeless faces weeping blood. Then a bit later we get even more weirwood imagery. A face took shape within the hearth. Stannis? She thought for just a moment, but no, these were not his features. A wooden face, corpse white. Was this the enemy? A thousand red eyes floated in the rising flames. "He sees me." Beside him a boy with a wolf's face threw back his head and howled. The Red Priestess shuddered, blood trickled down her thigh, black and smoking. The fire was inside her, an agony and ecstasy, filling her, searing her, and transforming her. Shimmers of heat traced patterns on her skin, insistent as a lover's hand. It is interesting and intriguing that Melisandre reacts this way to a vision of Bran and Bloodraven. The imagery used is eerily similar to that used by Salladhor Saan when he is telling Davos the story of Lightbringer and Nissa Nissa. It was Nissa Nissa's cry of anguish and ecstasy as the sword pierced her heart that cracked the moon. I'm not saying that Mel is Nissa Nissa, nor that Bran or Bloodraven are Azor Ahai, only that the imagery George chose to use is similar and that the similarity is not coincidental. The flames crackled softly, and in their crackling she heard the whispered name, Jon Snow. His long face floated before her, limbed in tongues of red and orange, appearing and disappearing again, a shadow half seen behind a fluttering curtain. Now he was a man, now a wolf, and now a man again, but the skulls were here as well, the skulls were all around him. Melisandre had seen this danger before, had tried to warn the boy of it. Enemies all around him, daggers in the dark, he would not listen, unbelievers never listened until it was too late. A short paragraph later and Mel is ruminating on her ability to interpret the flames, an ability that she believes exceeds the abilities of others, and then complains when she asks the Lord to show her Azor Ahai and she sees only snow. We gotta remember when we're reading this, the snow is actually capitalized. The snow is capitalized so that we know that it is Jon Snow and not a winter storm. Her visions of Jon have led to many popular theories and are used by many as proof that Jon is Azor Ahai. The wolf imagery has led to a popular book theory that when Jon is stabbed and he dies, he will enter ghost for his second life, which we see skin changers do in the books. This did not transpire in the show, but it would have been difficult to show this in a visual medium. It is also interesting to see how Bran is a boy with a wolf's face, while Jon is a man, then a wolf, then a man again, which could also symbolize the maturity of their skin-changing abilities. Book readers talk much about what these visions mean for Jon, but much less about what they mean for Bran. While Melisandre sees visions in her flames, Bran sees his visions from the ice. He does not see it in ice, but sees it through the weirwood tree in a frozen land. Melisandre asks R'hllor to show her his king, his instrument, and she is shown the weirwood faces and those with whom those faces communicate. And yet Melisandre shows no respect for those weirwood trees, she sees them as a false god. But when Stannis offers to legitimize Jon and make him Lord of Winterfell, that offer is contingent upon him burning the weirwood tree at the Winterfell Godswood. But why is Melisandre insisting on burning those trees when she sees them in her flames? There is no weirwoods at Dragonstone, there is no weirwoods at Castle Black, but surely Melisandre has seen a weirwood with a carved face before. Or perhaps not. Unbelievers never listen until it's too late, she says, but is she making the same mistakes herself? When Melisandre sees the red eyes looking out of the flame, she thinks, he sees me. When Bran is in his visions and he sees the Night King, he realized that the Night King saw him and touched him. He comes back saying, he just saw me. Again, eerily similar imagery is used here. Is Melisandre just assuming that anybody or anything that looks back through her flames is the enemy? The weirwoods and Bran are obviously very important to the story, and it appears as though both are instruments of R'hllor in his battle against the Great Other. But how will this manifest in the final season of the show? What we saw of Bran in season 7 was little and rather underwhelming. But there are many wonderful magical things in the books that have been left out of the show. The wolf dreams of Arya and Jon, the Horn of Winter, the Dragonbinder Horn, and even much of the magic and mystery of the weirwood trees and the blood sacrifices that are made to them through tradition with more understanding. In the Theon sample chapter from the Winds of Winter, Stannis has Theon captive and chained with the intent of executing him and feeding him to the flames. It is Theon's sister who suggests to Stannis that he execute Theon in a northern way, beheading him with the magic sword under the weirwood tree the way that Ned Stark would have done. At this suggestion, the ravens are saying, tree, tree, and Theon. This suggests the weirwoods and the blood sacrifice to them have more power than the sacrifice to the flames. Will this foreshadowing in the books translate to the show, or will the two storytelling mediums diverge for the final battle for Dawn? While in the show we have 6 episodes left and possibly around 8 hours of storytelling, in the books we have potentially 2,000 pages of text and 80 hours of audio. It is more likely that the weirwoods will play a larger role in the books than in the show, but will the weirwoods play a bigger role than being a search engine in the show? Could Bran be this instrument of R'hllor? Melisandre prays to be shown R'hllor's king, his instrument, and she is shown both Bran and Jon, which may indicate that they are a team in this battle, though neither knows it yet. It will be interesting to see how this unfolds in the final season of the show and the last 2 books of the series. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to leave a comment in the comment section. Let's create an epic discussion. And if you do want to see more of these kinds of videos or chat about your favorite theories, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell and follow me on Twitter. Message me, let me know what you would like to see in the next video. Also, a big thank you for those of you who support the channel on Patreon. We are 103 strong in the Hype and Love family. Super hype. If you do want to become a patron of the channel and get bonus content every single day, that's right. Every single day there's bonus content. Click the link in the description of this video. It's super easy to sign up, and your support goes towards helping me attend awesome events like Con of Thrones 2018. Also, a big thank you to all of you who have donated to the GoFundMe for Con of Thrones 2018. Going to an event like this is extremely expensive for someone like myself. So if you do decide to donate and help me get to Con of Thrones 2018 to Dallas, Texas, it will give me the perfect opportunity to create new content. For example, I can do live video logs of the event, interviews with the fans of the Song of Ice and Fire and Game of Thrones community, public polls and questionnaires, live panel footage, live interviews with the actors, collaborations with other content creators, a live podcast, and of course, exclusive behind-the-scenes footage of my week in Texas. You can find the link to donate and help out in the description of this video. Thanks for watching. Hype and love.